I want to share something from John chapter 1. We talked about this fellow, I don't know, seems like years ago, but we did, but a lot of things happened since then, and it's alive in a new way. So let's go to John chapter 1. And 43. Okay, John chapter 1 and verse 43. The next day, Jesus purposed to go forth into Galilee. He found Philip, and Jesus said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him, of whom Moses in the law and also in the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." And Nathanael said to him, "Can any good thing come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "You'd better come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him, and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered and said to him, "Because I said to you that I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You shall see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you shall see the heavens opened, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." It's fascinating to see how Jesus called the disciples, the guys we call the disciples. A few weeks, months ago, we talked about that. Disciple, you remember I said, was a very bad translation. It's the Latin. And this was supposed to be Hebrew. And the Hebrew word there is one that is leaving an imprint, mimicking even. It is that a rabbi would call disciples. Well, see, we say disciples. His word was one who he's going to imprint his image upon them. And much different to all of the cold ideas of disciple, you know, discipleship in churches. You go and you see a pile of books and pencils, and they're going to study. And that's no, a disciple in the Hebrew sense was, I'm going to teach you by my life how you live this Christian life. And also, we have been inundated by Hollywood over the years, and they have dared to give ages to these men, and so you get the, especially when it comes to Nathanael. I think usually Hollywood portrays him as a bald fellow with a few strands of hair left. If you realize by the end of the New Testament, and by that time we are dealing with AD 60, coming on AD 70 in some cases, and these fellows were still around, traveling, writing, speaking. If this man was the old fellow that Hollywood portrays him to be, he must have been 150 by the end of the New Testament. No, all disciples, under that same Hebrew way, they were teenagers. I know it's a radical change of mind, but the men we meet and call them disciples, the only one that would be above teenage would possibly be Peter, because he was married, and you can't get married under that system until you're 18. And so he was married and probably the oldest among them, or maybe Judas was in that character too. But essentially, when you meet all these others, you're dealing with a bunch of teenagers, older teenagers, but teenagers. John was the youngest we know. He probably was around 14 or 15. Makes it a lot more fun. Anyway, enough of that. Nathaniel, let me repeat, was no old fellow. He was a young buck, and he was friends with Philip, who again was another teenager. Teenagers, of course, I don't know if you can imagine them, they didn't have cell phones, and therefore they had minds that were wide open to truth. You find it says here, Philip goes to Nathanael and says, "We found him that Moses and the prophets speak of." Many teenagers today would just look at you, duh, well, I mean, what do you mean? These guys immediately come alive because they have been taught the scripture and they are waiting, anticipating the coming of Messiah. And when they can speak in that kind of language, way ahead of where teenagers today would be in terms of seeking after truth. Jesus has come back from the wilderness, his encounter with Satan, and he now begins calling John and Andrew. And then he found Philip, and then Philip goes to find Nathanael. And out of this, there comes these two great prophecies that are very exciting because they reach all the way to us. Nathanael, the word Nathanael means gift of God. His name had been given by his parents as essentially grace, gift God gives. And you might be confused. He's mostly spoken of by his father's name. Whenever you see in the scripture, especially Old Testament, the Hebrew word B-A-R, Bar, means son of. And so he's known, Nathanael is known throughout the rest of the Gospels as Bar, son of Tholomew. And so Bartholomew is the, shall I say, family name of Nathanael. And so Nathanael, who was the gift of God, son of Tholomew. And that's how you identify him later on. Philip is very excited. We don't really know very much about how Jesus revealed himself to him, except he said he found him, and Philip gets it. And he's alive with this reality that Jesus is the Messiah and the one that was spoken of in the prophets. And he goes in that excitement to find Nathanael. I say they appear to be buddies. In all the lists of these men later on in the Gospels, Philip and Bartholomew or Nathanael, they're always together. They seem to be buddies who studied the scripture together. And he comes and he's full of it. He said, we found him, the Messiah, the one that we've been looking at in the scriptures, he's there. And then he says it, Jesus of Nazareth, because he got it wrong. He said, son of Joseph, but we'll forgive him for that. He's only been around a few days. But he got it right, Jesus of Nazareth. And immediately Nathanael backs off. But would you understand when I said that that wasn't Nathanael's idea of Messiah? Nathanael had a much more beautiful picture of Messiah. And the idea of him coming from Nazareth was offensive to him. Nazareth, it had a bad name, a very bad name. In some respects, I'm probably overspeaking here, but it was sort of a micro Las Vegas, kind of. Because right on the edge, bordering onto Nazareth, there was a Roman fort or barracks. And so when the Romans were off duty, they went into Nazareth and they demanded the entertainment, they demanded it become the city they wanted. And so if you go into Nazareth, you're going to find a bunch of crooks, you're going to find the mafia, you're going to find everything that goes with the entertainment that the Romans wanted. And to say that you came from Nazareth, you almost had to excuse yourself to begin with. It was a shame to have come from Nazareth. And so he now says the Messiah has come. We've met him and he comes from Nazareth. And that's when Nathanael responds, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? You've got to be kidding. My Messiah doesn't fit that. His Messiah would be entertained by the rich religious. He would know the dirt of Nazareth, even talking to most of the people who live there, for goodness sake. No, not Nazareth. He would be served fruit on a tray by Gentile slaves. He would be looked upon as someone holy, someone special, someone. Yeah. Now it's been dashed to the ground. Jesus of Nazareth. You'd have a hard job finding even a clean spot to sit down if you're that kind of Messiah. Not Nazareth. There'd be no company to visit with. No one's worthy of the conversation that Messiah would have. Not in Nazareth. And so he is pulled very reluctantly by Philip to come and see what he's looking upon as his would-be Messiah. Suspicious. He disdains the simplicity of a Messiah that would be raised on the streets of Nazareth. He is ready for a doctrinal fight. We'll soon see if this one is the right one. And because Jesus always avoided that. He never would have a doctrinal fight. He always knocked you off your feet before you had a chance. And so before the man had a chance to confront him on Messiah coming from Nazareth, Jesus said, here comes an Israelite, a real one, in whom there's no deceit. Now, does that ring a bell in your mind? Okay. Do you remember the original Israelite? Okay. Have you ever heard of Jacob? Abraham, Isaac. Isaac had twins, Jacob and Esau. And Jacob had that wrestling with God, and God changed his name to Israel. Ah, okay, now you're with me. But do you remember what they said about Jacob before God changed his name? I've said, would you buy a used car from Jacob? Jacob was double-tongued. He was, I wouldn't trust Jacob as far as I could see him. He was his brother, his twin brother Esau. He was a hunter. He was a man's man. And when Dad Isaac wanted to have some good food, he called Esau and said, "You gotta go and get some game." Jacob sits in the corner. He's planning, and he wants, because Esau was born first. So he's the oldest brother by a few minutes. But in those days, that counted a lot. That meant he got the blessing of Abraham. And Jacob is determined he's going to have the blessing of Abraham. And he goes through all of that planning of putting goat's hair on his arm so he feels like Esau, the hairy fellow. And you remember the story. Jacob was everything that was hypocrite. He was everything that was manipulator. He didn't want to be around Jacob too long because he's going to use you. This is the way he was. I tend to enjoy Esau much more. It's a shame because poor Esau, you know, he was just a sort of hunting guy who didn't think very much beyond the next stupa. Yeah. And so, whatever. Jacob was the hypocrite, but then he was changed to Israel, which means a prince with God. But Jesus comes and says, wow, we've got a real one here. He says, we have an Israelite who didn't begin as a Jacob. We've got an Israelite in whom there is no guile. There's no twist. There's no hypocrisy. You're an honest man, Nathaniel, and you might sneer at me living in Nazareth, but you're an honest man. And I love you for it. You're an Israelite in whom there is no guile. Nathaniel, he's lost all of his doctrinal fight. He stands there. Now it's a gut punch. How do you know me? He had to thank him for the honor of what he said. An Israelite in whom there's no guile. Really, thank you. I. But how do you know me? We've never met. How do you know me? Know you? I know you as you have never even known yourself. I know who you really are. You are the Jacob turned into a prince. And you sit with God. And he talks to you, and you talk to him in place of truth and light. I know you. In fact, you know, before Philip called you, so let's get that out of the way. I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about when he told you about me. Leave that. It's before Philip. But do you remember that other day? The day before Philip. And you were sitting under your fig tree. And you'll never forget that day. You sit under your fig tree many a day, but that day, all I have to say is the day you were under your fig tree, and you know what I'm talking about. Do you know, Nathaniel? I saw you. I know you. At which point, Nathaniel lost it. It becomes almost comical. Somebody said, I saw you under a tree. And he responded, you're the Son of God. You're the King of Israel. And it's almost as if Jesus smiles. He says, boy, do you believe just because I saw you under a tree? He said, I tell you, you're going to see greater things than that. What on earth is going on here? Obviously, it's something very big. When Nathaniel responds like that, first of all, it says the fig tree. We've got one at the entrance of the ranch. I don't know if you've ever seen it. It's a poor, pathetic thing. And it no way reflects what these guys had. But the fig tree is like a gigantic umbrella and made of leaves. And that's how it grows. And you can go in a proper one, you can go underneath there, and you are there in your own private room. You've got a room encompassed by leaves, and the sun can't burn you, and people can't see you and bother you. You are in your little space, your fig tree. Not everybody had them. It was understood that if you got any money at all, you're going to get yourself a fig tree so you can have a place where you can go and sit and meditate and pray and study the scriptures. That's what godly Jews were expected to do. And so a prosperity that they associated with the coming of Messiah, prosperity was every man sits under his own fig tree. Chicken in every pot sort of thing, you know. It was, you have enough money to buy the tree, you've got enough money to sit there when you bought it, and you can be a person that, no distractions, you've got your fig tree, and there you are, and you can, it's not only a sign of abundance and enough money to buy it, it was that you've got time to indulge, you've got time to wait, you've got time to let God speak to you. And as I said, it was a symbol then of the Messiah's kingdom. When he comes, we'll have all the time in the world to sit under our fig tree and let God speak to us. So it anticipates a day of fellowship. It anticipates a day of friendship. You're going to know God, and you're going to know him so deeply that you'll be happy to sit and talk with him for hours on end if necessary. You're not afraid of him. There's no separation. It's you're with him under your fig tree. And it became the idea that when Messiah came and you've got your fig tree, that would mean it's a day of great peace. Because if there's any war going on or there's any trouble in the land, you don't have the time to go under the fig tree. And it might actually be a dangerous place to be. So when Messiah comes, can you get into that mood? Can you get into their head when Messiah comes? And many times it was just when Messiah comes. But the likes of Nathaniel, it really was when Messiah comes. And he went there to find that very thing, peace that passes human comprehension. That's what they were waiting for. In Hebrew, they have no one word for that. And so peace that is beyond thought, peace that is perfect peace, in Hebrew is peace. It's a double peace. I've got peace on top of peace, and I'm waiting for that. Jesus said, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives peace. I am saying, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Okay, the messianic prophecies in Micah and chapter 4, verse 4, it says, every man shall be under his fig tree with no one to make them afraid. The mouth of the Lord has spoken it. He said, the day is coming of such peace that you cannot imagine. The closest I can get to it is every man's got a fig tree. And the closest I can say, there's nothing out there outside the fig tree to make you afraid. The absence of anxiety. But he coupled that, it wasn't only the peace, there was a solid rock on which that peace was built. And the prophet said, let me read it to you from Zechariah especially, chapter 3. He said, I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day. In that day, declares the Lord of hosts, every one of you will invite his neighbor to sit under his vine and under his fig tree. He said it will be peace. Why? Because in one day I'll wipe sin out of the country. You will be cleansed in one day. And in that same one day, I'll introduce you to a life of fig trees, where you will live in peace without anxiety. You'll have peace with God and peace with yourself, and so much peace with your neighbor, you will invite them into your sacred space, and you can sit there together with your neighbor and have fellowship. The Amplified Version sometimes throws more light. He says, I will remove the iniquity. and the guilt of this land in a single day. You think about it. The Israel only knew of the Day of Atonement, and that really didn't do, they knew it didn't do anything. It was more like an IOU. And next year we come back. And forever the blood of the sacrifices ran in the temple. And God says, I'm going to deal with this whole thing in one day. Get it over with. One day. And in that one day, you, every one of you, will invite his neighbor to sit under his vine and under his fig tree. I wrote the wrong. It says, shall invite each man his neighbor under his own vine and his own fig tree. You'll have your own fig tree, and you can invite your neighbor for the fellowship. The Hebrew language has no future tense. We dealt with that some months ago. It's hard to think of not being able to speak of the future. Yeah. But the Hebrews did not have a future tense. They lived by what God had said in the past, which was being fulfilled in the present. And anything that God will do is spoken of as done. They couldn't think of a God who had to wait to do something. And so it was always a present tense. There was never a waiting. And the only translator that got a hold of that was a chap called Young back in the 1800s. And he rewrote the Bible based on that, that there's no future tense to Hebrew. So he says there in those prophets, I have removed the iniquity of that land in one day. In that day, ye do call each unto his neighbor, unto the place of the vine, unto the place of the fig tree. He said, what can I say? I'm trying to make you feel this, that the church today has not moved very much beyond the Day of Atonement. It's every Sunday they go forward to confess their sins again. For goodness sake, would somebody tell them Jesus came? The new covenant, the New Testament has nothing to do with the old. In fact, he says in Hebrews that the old covenant is now ready to be shredded. Yes. It's finished. And we do not have a consciousness of sin. We do not forever be going forward to have our own private Day of Atonement. He said, I've done it, it's finished. And I like the Message. Sometimes he really has a way with things. He said, in the Message, he said, I'll strip this land of its filthy sin, and I'll do it all at once in a single day. And at that time, everyone will get along with one another, with friendly visits across the fence, friendly visits on one another's porches. He's got the idea what he was saying. Okay. Nathaniel is sitting under a fig tree. And as we see in a minute, it was Messiah, he's meditating on Messiah. And the reality of this has gripped him, a reality that the presence of Messiah seems to fill the tent of leaves that he's sitting under. It's so real, he can't forget that day. Jesus doesn't have to explain it. That's all he had to say that day. It was there. Fig tree had come alive to him, come alive. But it seems that on this day, that was the most wonderful day, that just the mention of it struck that chord down inside of him. What was he meditating on? He's in that place that is almost become a visitation from the future. He's almost sitting there in Messiah's kingdom. But what was he talking to God about? What was his meditation? I'm going to take a leap and say it was Genesis 28. because Jesus finished off after he had taken the breath out of the man just by mentioning the fig tree. He then goes on to say, what you're going to see is the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. What is in Genesis 28? The angels of God ascending and descending upon Jacob's ladder. And so you've got that Jacob, who now has been turned to Israel, and you have this that it appears he was meditating on. Wow. Huh. Genesis 28, we've hardly got started. You know, we've got creation out of the way, and we've now had Abraham, who has entered into God's covenant with him. And then it comes to Jacob, the grandson of Abraham. And he had twisted, lied about his brother and him so that he can get the blessing of Abraham, which came through that covenant. That's not the way to get a blessing, but it was Jacob's way. And so Esau, who only had one way of dealing with such things, which is fight, kill. So Jacob runs for his life. And in those days, that's dangerous. To be out there, one man, in the middle of total unknown territory. And he runs until the sun goes down. And he comes at that point to a city that was called Luz. And he didn't go into the city. He doesn't know who's in there. That might be a dangerous place to go. And so he takes a stone and he lays his head on the stone out there on the edge of civilization, and he goes to sleep. And in his sleep, the Lord visits him with a strange dream. He sees a ladder, and it was firmly set into the earth, and it stretched out into, it says heaven, but we're going to understand it, it's more like heavens. You see, it's talking about the outer space. And as he looked upon it, he saw the Lord, the glory of the Lord, standing at the top. And he repeated to Jacob, as if Jacob had never heard it before, the same covenant that he'd made with Abraham. Jacob, 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 you're ready to go into a family fight and kill your brother to get the blessing. And I've been waiting to give it to you anyway. Here you are. And the blessing, which says that I give to you this land, and you will expand and go to the east and the west and the north and the south and become this great nation. But it won't just be you, because you will have a seed, you'll have an descendant. And in that descendant, every family on the face of the planet, every family in all of creation ever been, every family of mankind shall be blessed. You thought you had to fight for it. I'm going to give it to everybody. It would be a descendant of you, Jacob. Interesting, fascinating. And he says the angels are going up the ladder, taking, as it were, all the pain and the sorrow of earth, and they return with the blessings of God. And as he woke up, he realized there was more going on here tonight than I ever dreamed. He said the Lord was in this place, and I didn't know it. It's interesting that there is one possible translation of that, where it says, the Lord was in this eye, and I didn't know it. I'll leave it at that. Your Bible say, in this place, and I knew it not. But the real possibility, that the Lord was in this eye. I was running to find you here. I'm willing to kill him to get you. And all the time you dwelled inside of me. And I woke up, you and from inside of me you talked to me in the dream. And you talked to me and you said that I will keep every promise I've ever made to you. And I will cause you not only to become a great nation, but the much more important thing is that at the end of that great nation stands one figure, and that through that one descendant, all families of the earth, Gentiles as well as Jews and Israel, they all be blessed. A ladder from heaven. In a day when all they knew was that God is up and we are down, and we've got to do and we've got to keep the law, and the separate, you lived in the sense of separation, as I say. Would somebody tell the church that Jesus came? Yeah. There is no separation. But the ladder was this, not a hint of it, it was in your face. There is a ladder that reaches from earth to heaven. You don't have to try and build one. You don't have to try and put the bricks of your good works together to make a bridge. The bridge is there, the ladder is there. There's no separation. The traffic freely flows from earth to heaven. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It was a dream. That's fascinating to me. Do you remember how Abraham entered into covenant with God? God put him to sleep. There's something about there. Why? It takes two people to make a covenant. And in Abraham's case, Abraham was the other person. God will enter into covenant with Abraham, but he puts him to sleep. And it's one of those sleeps, you know, where you see it happening and your arms won't move and your legs won't, like, I can't do this. All I can do is see God entering into covenant with me, but I'm not there. God takes my place as well as his place. God enters into covenant with God and makes me the receptor of the covenant. And I could never, never have that explained to me. It's beyond explanation, so God put me to sleep. And there I see it. And by the time Jacob, the grandson, comes along, they pretty well have forgotten that. And so, what does he do? Puts him to sleep on nothing less than a stone. And in the sleep, what does he see? But exactly the same thing. He's an observer. He's a watchman. He's standing somewhere adjacent to the ladder, and he can look up and he can see the glory of God. And he looks down and he sees the ladder firmly in the earth. But all he's doing is standing here. And yet the Lord is speaking to him and says, I've made promises to you through Abraham. I'm going to keep every promise I've ever made to you. And then he goes right on through it, as I said. Yes, you're going to become a great nation. But that one at the end of the line, your descendant, the seed of Abraham, through that one, all families of the earth shall be blessed. It was a dream. When are we going to get a hold of this? There's not one jolly thing we can do to help God's covenant. And really, it's underscored in all these promises God makes. You cannot. Right down to the disciples, when Jesus said that he was coming to prepare a place for us, and they said, then we will come with you. And he says, where I'm going, you cannot come. Cannot come. No human being can have a fingerprint on God's salvation. You cannot. He'll put you to sleep so you can see it without being able to touch it. He will tell you plainly, you cannot come. And when the time actually came, they ran away and he let them run. He didn't condemn them for running because this was none of their business. You cannot. And there are many that would say that while immediately limit the persons who can receive it according to their works. It's so difficult for people to even begin to believe, to touch it, that I can't do anything here. And I think a great deal of problem is that we have talked about Jesus doing something for us. And I know the scripture says he died for us, but as we say in our liturgy, he died for us by dying as us. The incarnation means he became us. There's not one part of my being. It's not only my spirit. It's through every cell of my mortal body, through every movement of my brain, imagination, every ligament, every artery, I was united with God in Jesus Christ. That's the incarnation. He became flesh, says John. He became sin, said Paul. He became the curse, became it. He didn't just do something with it. He didn't have some deal going on with the Father, and then having made the deal, he comes over to you and says, now I did this for you, if you want it, if you want it. You are involved in God's salvation whether you want it or not. Did you know that? Because Jesus is God's salvation and he made himself to be one with you. And you are one with him. And he carried you and I to the cross. He carried us in himself to death. And then he carried us in himself to resurrection. He's the one doing it. Whose faith could walk through those sufferings of Jesus? Whose faith could jump into death and believe he will come out again, having put away sin by the sacrifice of himself? Who? I couldn't do that. He said, I must believe, you must believe. Believe what? I believe he did it. I have no faith that would carry me through it. I live now, I live by the faith of the Son of God. He carried us. He put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. It didn't wait for me to say, I want that, I want that. He did it. And I am presented with the finished work. You did it. And that's what changes everything. This is wonderful, you see. Wonderful being, another Hebrew word, which means something that humankind is incapable of thinking of. I am incapable of planning it. It is totally beyond me to even consider such a thing happening. And wonderful also means, therefore, that a human being is incapable of producing it. Well, that's salvation, and that's why it says it's wonderful. Another word we translate that same word with is marvelous. Marvelous, wonderful, impossible is another word. That those, they all go together. You can't. And it's a marvelous feeling to settle down like on a cold winter's night and pull the covers around your neck. You rest into it. I can do absolutely nothing. With men, it is impossible. I can enter God's dream, and I'll dream with his dream, and I'll say the amen at the end of it. But I can't do anything. When God made covenant with us, he took our place as well as his own. It isn't that, as I've heard often, and it can be misunderstood, that sort of Jesus took our place, and so God the Father entered into covenant with God the Son. Not here. This is the covenant that starts in Genesis and goes all the way through the scripture, is God takes the place not only of himself in making covenant, but he takes the place of us. So God enters into covenant with God. And then says, it's mine. I have said Abraham, Jacob, and us, in that sense, cannot break this covenant. We never signed it. You follow me? God says, I'm entering into covenant with Abraham, but I know Abraham will blow it within 24 hours. So step aside and go to sleep. You can watch me do this. And he takes the place of Abraham as well as himself. And God enters into covenant with God, with Abraham, represented, carried within God. All Abraham has to do, which it says he did, Abraham believed God. What else can I do? Abraham, and do you remember I told you the word believe there is amen. Amen. So Abraham looked at all that God did and all that he didn't do and said, amen, that is the way it is. I rest. And that's true, friend. We need the, what can I say? We need the intervention of God to bring about that rest. Yes. Mm-hmm. Because it's too crazy for us.
Yeah.
But I am looking at God himself, abolishing the separation that mankind has self-given. Mm-hmm. Man has self-separated himself from God. Mm-hmm. So God steps into our earth. God himself is the ladder. Mm-hmm. He steps. Too much of the church today is outrageous. Just what I've said in the last 15 minutes is outrageous to much in the church. God no longer is remote. He's no longer up. He's no longer distant to be feared. We don't hide from God anymore. We don't actually, I mean, don't get technical on me, but kneeling and prostrating and wailing before God, I'm unworthy. That's not biblical. God says, stand erect on 2 feet. You're no longer slaves. You no longer bow your back. You stand. All Jewish prayer was done standing. It was Greek influence from outside of the gospel that caused men to kneel and to be, I'm unworthy. No, you're not. You're not. God has recreated you to stand erect, look him in the face, and know that he took my place, redeemed me to put me where he is. That's where it is. Dream my person. Realize I put you in me and I carried you where I am. All families of the earth. And Nathaniel sees it. I don't know how much he saw, but he saw enough. He could never forget it. Sitting in his little tent of leaves, meditating on Genesis 28, he realizes there's a stairway to heaven. God put it there. He lets me see it and say, amen, so be it. And he waits for the seed of Abraham that shall bring it all about. And that was some day before Philip showed up. And when Philip showed up, Philip says, the one that Moses spoke of and the pro, that's the one that's dominated all my thoughts and cries this long while. That now he's excited. And Jesus said, let's separate. You got excited over what Philip said. Well, put that aside. I want to go back before Philip. Do you remember when you were under the fig tree? That begins to make my... See, Jesus claimed right there to be the ladder. He says, you think what you saw under the fig tree is something? Well, what you're going to see outruns that. Because you saw there is a ladder. And God spoke in the present tense. But in a very short time, you're going to see that I'm the ladder. And they're ascending on me. I am the way, the truth, and the life, you see. I am. And when Jesus said, I am the way, or in this upon me, the Son of Man, it's not outside himself. Jesus didn't give us a new law which constituted the ladder. You follow me? See, in the Middle Ages, there were many Christians. They believed that there was a new law, Jesus' law, and keep that as, and there's a ladder, and they described it as a ladder. You do this, you do that, you do that, you do that, and you're climbing up the ladder. Jesus didn't give us a law to keep. He says, I am the way. And I don't climb on Jesus. I am so one with him where he is, I am. So if he's the ladder, I'm there. I'm home. I've arrived. I was with a company of pastors once. We spent the whole day these are pastors, and they spend the whole day debating how one gets into Christ. And someone's got to tell you, you're in. You were born in. Jesus came and he took the human race to himself. We don't do anything to get in. We're in, and suddenly then we're speechless. We don't know what to do with that. Our vocabulary is made up of get what we don't have.
Yes.
And we suddenly come upon the goodest news you've ever heard, that you have what you haven't even thought of yet. He's not a map. He doesn't give himself to us and say, now try and follow the way home. He says, I am the way, I am the map. He's not a guide for religious tourists. Now I do this, get off here, turn it off. He is. And of course, that's where that word metanoia that we've talked about in these last months, metanoia. And if you don't remember, that's the word that's so mistranslated as repentance, which bears with it all the baggage of doing something, penitence and penance. But metanoia, it means eyes are open, I see, it's the opening of inner eyes. And really, you'd have to say the blazing forth of a divine light in the proclamation of the gospel. This isn't just a little seeing that moves you from, you know, one grade to another. This is a forever life-changing light. In that light you see all things, and in that light you see where all things fit, and you see that everything I've believed up until now was off. It's metanoia, that's the word. It's a radical enlightenment. It's a change of mind that of course changes your behavior, but the behavior isn't changed to get it. The light is God's gift, and in the light I see, you know, what am I doing this? Well, I don't need this, it's gone. It's a reorientation. I've discovered who God is, and in so doing, discovered who I am. So it's a fundamental change of outlook and expectancy of life. It's a fundamental seeing of those who make up my world to a new way of loving God and loving others. He never forgot it. You can't unsee what you've seen. You can't unhear what you've heard in the depth of your spirit. He had visited in that canopy of a fig tree. And he couldn't be. He'd seen something that changed him forever. When I say that, there are times when such seeings seem to fade a bit. Because my senses lose the impact of that light. But, how can I put it? I still can't pretend I didn't see it. It's faded, maybe. There are times when I sit on my bed and say, did it ever really happen? But when Jesus comes under the fig tree, you can't forget it. And I'm speaking to us because in it, we're in the same place as Nathaniel, but a little different. The seed of Abraham has come. The new covenant is here. Every promise has been fulfilled. Our problem is we haven't seen it. There's been no metanoia in many places. And when it does happen, many times it is one slice of that, one part of that. I tell you, take it very seriously. I told you, let me quickly tell you again, because remember, I had a very close friend who was a rock star of the 1970s, and he, one of those, you know, had purple hair, and his claim to fame was he broke guitars over his knee every time he got out there, and a lot of crazy stuff. And he decided one day he wanted to know what Jesus was all about. Just like that. Thought dropped into his head. And so he pulled over into a shopping center and scared witless some poor soul who was the person in charge of the Bible bookstore. He and the whole gang of people who broke guitars with him went into the store and asked for a Bible. And he got King James Bible. And that night, after the whatever they did, they got in their bus, they're going to drive all night to the next appointment. And so he sat down, he had a big chair right at the front of the bus, and that was his chair, and he sat in the chair. And he always did it every night. He drank half a bottle of Southern Comfort to quieten him down. And then he would gradually nod off into this, you know, drunken sleep. But tonight he picked up the Bible that he bought and began looking at it. Most of it didn't make any, he's just turning the pages. And suddenly there was this one verse, it just leaped out as if speaking to him. And it was so real that he couldn't let the Southern Comfort do its work. And so he got cocaine and put it on the Bible and snorted the cocaine from the Bible so he could read the Bible. And crazy, this is a true story. And he said, as he, you know, now he's got his senses back together. And now he begins, and the whole of that part of the scripture keeps lighting up. And it was a long road, but that happened every night thereafter. And he gradually came to know Jesus. But now he became a pastor in Miami. And he's preaching on the grace of God one night. And suddenly, as he's moving, he comes to the center, and there's the aisle down the center of the church. And he's preaching right at the head of it. And suddenly he's in the bus.
Wow.
And he's standing at the back of the bus. And he sees himself sitting in that big chair down at the front. And he sees himself drink the Southern Comfort and take his Bible. And as he opened it, he saw a person who was light, just solid light, come and sit beside him and reach over and point. And it all lit up. And he saw, and he realized this was, and he said when he snorted the cocaine, the person just sat back and let him do it, and then moved in and took him from there. And he said it was such a wonderful that there, it wasn't a church member sitting beside him. It was the Holy Spirit, he said, and always pointing. And every time they point, the whole light lit up. I'm trying to say that there are days in our life when whole areas of God's covenant just light up to us. Have you ever thought that the living Jesus is right there in you and with you, and the Holy Spirit, who doesn't replace Jesus, he points the light at him and glorifies him. And there you are, you're in the middle of this festival of lights, and the Holy Spirit is showing you, and you're discovering Jesus where you never knew him before. Never forget that. At your day under a fig tree.
Yes.
And Jesus said, I saw you. Mm-hmm. That's not what I'm doing now. This is, that word there is what you would do after maybe years of study. And you say, I see it. It means I've got discernment. I finally understand it. That's the word saw there. It can be translated as know. I know it. I see it. I've discerned your true heart. I know you, said Jesus, as the Father knows you. In fact, we, the Father and I, have talked about you. And we've shared our love for you. We, Holy Trinity, have spoken of your specialness to us. I know you. Oh, I know you. We've talked about you. In fact, before the foundation of the world, we were talking about you. Couldn't wait to meet you. And you felt my knowing you. The scales fell off your eyes there under the fig tree. It's still true. Jesus makes himself known to us as he makes known to us how much he knows us. Cherish that day. never to be forgotten, because it's part of something bigger. Now, it wasn't a dead end. It was enough to make him ready for what was coming. But what was coming was everything you saw there in Genesis 28, and a million times more is about to happen. Yeah, you're there. See, when he's drawing us on, when we're in that position, in that invisible world, something is happening. There are things in our life that we couldn't live without, and we realize we can live without it, and it can go. There's pieces of furniture in our life that we've just always been there, and they're moving now. There's a big moving going on. Things are changing. It's as if there's a hand that is reaching through from the invisible, and it is rearranging our life. It's as if we can hear the footsteps of the shepherd coming through, getting ready to put us around his neck. Something's happening. You get on a river and you feel the pull of the current. You haven't done anything except you suddenly realize things are going past faster than they were before. Yet you're in a current. There's something infinitely more than a magnetic field, but we're in it. And everything is changing. And that, to our senses, that interprets as restlessness. We don't always see what it is, but we're suddenly restless. I was satisfied with my life. I was satisfied, now I'm dissatisfied. I'm restless. Something's afoot. If you've read Narnia, Aslan's on the move. You know, it's the pull of love, the current of love. Silent, very silent, hardly discernible, but it's bringing discontent. And it's causing a longing. You've been spoiled for religion in all its faces. I'm dissatisfied with what I was satisfied with yesterday. I've seen something. I've seen too much. I can't unsee it. And I've figured for the present, well, that was it. No, it wasn't it. That was just part of this big thing that's going on. And you can thank God for the restlessness. Thank God that you're asking questions. Thank God you're feeling discomfort. Because that constitutes the cup into which the new life is poured. Yes. Without all those questions, you'd never recognize the answer when it came. Right. No. So it doesn't matter how big the questions are, it just means there's a big answer coming. And you're getting that reaction to the beckoning finger of the love of God. And you weren't alone. When you were under the fig tree, I saw you. I knew you. I talked with the Father about you. You were the beloved, and it was just time to say, call you on. Or he said later, he said it in John 14, 15, I and the Father, we will come and make our abode with you. One more thing. At the end there, Jesus said, I say to you, and the Greek words there, I say to you, is to you. It's singular. But the next word, in depending how it's translated, but more or less you can see it, the next word, Jesus said, I say unto you, singular, to you, Nathaniel. But the next word is you, but this is plural. So I say to you, Nathaniel, you, all families of the earth,
yes,
shall see the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. What I started to show you, Nathaniel, you're the gateway to the whole jolly world. You show the world. One man's private time becomes the feast of the world.
Oh, come on.
Yeah. We will come. And so it is. We've entered into this. In Christ, we tread Christ.
Yeah.
And with his resurrection, we ascend.
Yeah.
He's the ladder, we ascend.
Yeah.
There's a lot in the news these days about what's happening in the British royalty. And kind of makes me sick. Give me a break. They're a bunch of naughty boys and girls, and there. But you might have heard that King Charles is in Australia. He's gone to visit the Commonwealth, and he was there when he was Prince of Wales. That was a long time ago. Prince of Wales is who you are before you become king. That's the track. And so he was there as Prince of Wales. So he was treated with royal respect. He's the next king. That's established. But he's not there yet. And then in Westminster Abbey, a few months ago, he was made king. And that, in British parlay of royalty, is he ascended the throne. And really, that is how the word ascension is understood in the Bible. Because when the Bible was first into English, America wasn't here. Sorry about that. But so all of those parts of language that you'll find in the Bible, you've got to go back to ancient English to find out what they mean. And in this particular article, they said that now he who was a Prince of Wales, now he's here. But they didn't put it like that. They said, now he's here after the ascension. And he has this added respect now. He's ascended. There was not once they said he was made king. They just said he ascended. And I don't know, it hit me. Jesus, and that boy, I've got to be careful now. But there is a real sense in which in the Gospels, Jesus is the Prince of Wales. He hardly mentions being Messiah, yet it's assumed. But in Acts chapter 2, it says he ascended and received the kingdom, and the Holy Spirit was given. And thereafter, from chapter 2 of Acts on, he's called the Christ, meaning Messiah. And so we are caught up in his ascension. We have received the Spirit. And we are now the ascended in Christ. And all of which we speak is ours. And the Holy Spirit is our constant companion to give us metanoia. Open our eyes. Say, this is who you are. Sitting in your fig tree, and even inviting me onto your porch, because that's the way it is.
Amen.
Amen. And amen. Father, thank you. Yes, thank you, thank you, thank you. What else is there left to say? That you have brought about this salvation, that you have told us individually, and through our individual seeings, you have made it real to so many people. We give you thanks. But grant us eyes open, wide, speak loudly in our hearts, that we shall become who we truly are. Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.